kids that age anymore. Christmas okay. So cute to see somebody else's kids doing this. Amen. You know, I don't know what it is about the Christmas story. And, you know, this time of year, I can't even imagine, probably 7-8 times I've come across this Christmas story, either in my devotions, or, you know, presented by the children, or listening to the radio, or something on the TV. And it never fails that the story of Christ's birth, it has a special draw to our lives. I mean, we can hear it, we can read of the event 50 times, and it still moves us. You know, the birth of our Savior. You know, certainly the theological truths cause us to come to a place in awe and wonder, especially as a Christian, understanding that, you know, the true meaning of Christmas, you know, that God became a man. Became just like us in flesh and blood. God came down to earth, stepped out of heaven in all of his glories to take on flesh and blood. That a Savior is being born. Someone who is going to change my standing before God when I give my life to him. A Savior is going to save me from my sin. Things like salvation and hope and heaven, they're all the theological truths that come out at Christmas time. But I think there's something more to the Christmas story than just the truth of the moment. I mean, that's unbelievable, you know, for us as Christians, all that this day represents. But I do believe in part why we are so drawn to the Christmas story is because of the simplicity of it. I mean, it is so down to earth in such a way that God chose to enter into this world. And the way he chose to enter allows each and every one of us to kind of relate to the story, to connect with what God is doing, you know, to be able to approach God. I mean, if you think about the main characters in this truth, I mean, you have carpenter, there's shepherds, there's a stable, you know, a birth. I mean, these are everyday, normal type of people activities that, you know, if we gave testimony that, you know, we all experienced throughout this year. And I think the very fact that the way he came, it helps us relate to the event. And in some ways, to even be able to see ourselves there. To see ourselves that if, you know, that it could have very easily have been me. I mean, these people were just carpenters and shepherds and just devoted Christians, you know, or followers of God at that time. And it very well could have been any of us that God would have brought in to witness the birth of his son. And everyone who comes to this child, everyone as we look at the Christmas story, brings their own personal reaction. In some ways, their own personality. I think about the shepherds. It says in Luke chapter 2:15, it says, when the angels had gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds began saying to one another, let us go straight to Bethlehem then and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. So they came in a hurry, and they found their way to Mary and Joseph, and the baby as he lay in the manger. When they had seen this, it says they made known the statement which had been told to them about this Christ. In other words, when they came in and they found Mary and Joseph, they began to tell Mary and Joseph, everybody in that stable, what the angels had said to them. So what was the statement? What did the angels say to them? What is it that the shepherds wanted to express when they saw the Christ child? It says in verse 9 of Luke 2, it says, and the angel of the Lord, this is what the angel said, and the angel of the Lord suddenly appeared and stood before the shepherds, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were terribly frightened. But the angel said to them, do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which shall be to all the people. For today in the city of David there has been born a Savior for you, who is Christ the Lord. So you just got to picture the shepherds as they come into the stable. And they began to make known to everybody what the angels have said about this child. To say a Savior is born to us. You know, he's Christ the Lord. It's a time of great joy for all of us. And we find it didn't stop there for the shepherds. And in fact, in verse 20 it says, the shepherds went back glorifying and praising God for all that they heard and saw just as had been told them. 8 days later, Christ would be brought to the temple for the traditional dedication time. And there, Christ is met by just faithful followers of God. The first was a man named Simeon. And the Bible introduces us to him very simply. It says in Luke 2:25, it says, "And there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout. And he was looking for the consolation of Israel, or the delivering of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him." So that's all we know about Simeon. He's in the temple. You know, he's probably there worshiping. He's faithful. You know, just lived out his faith. Like you and I, you know, are called to do every single moment. And then suddenly, he sees the child, and God, the Holy Spirit, lays upon him that this is the consolation of Israel. This is the deliverer. This is the Messiah. This is the Savior. And it says in Luke 2:27, "And he came in the Spirit to the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to carry out for him the customs of the law, then he took him in his arms, and he blessed God, and he said, 'Now, Lord, you are releasing your bondservant to depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the presence of all the people, a light of revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel.'" I mean, his reaction, just a common person, just like you and I in their day and age, just like you and I are here in the culture that we live, simply following God, and God allows him to see the Christ child. And this is what he says. He says, "Lord, you're releasing your bondservant to depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation." Literally what he is saying is God has been worth it all. A life lived for you, a life dedicated to you. Lord, you can take me home. I've seen your salvation. I've seen the Savior. While they're in the temple, another woman came up to him named Anna. Verse 38, it says, "At that very moment she came up, and she began giving thanks to God and continued to speak of him to all those who were looking for the redemption of Israel." Her reaction is she gave thanks, she praised, she worshiped, and she continued to speak of him. I mean, you kind of get the idea. Here she's going around, she's telling everybody about Jesus. This child, it's the Messiah. Hey, guess what? The Savior is here. And she just, you know, just overflowed. She couldn't keep it within her anymore. And we all know that a year or so later, there was a group of wise men that came to see the infant. And it says in Matthew chapter 2, verse 11, it says, speaking of the wise men, it says, "After coming into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell to the ground and they worshipped him. Then opening their treasures, they presented him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh." And it's so interesting. This is the same child that everybody is coming to. But there are all sorts of different reactions. Some are, you know, overwhelmed. They're going, running out, telling other people. Some fall down and they're worshiping. You know, the wise men, you know, they begin to give gifts. And each of them, when they come to Jesus, is able to express themselves openly, honestly, and freely. And I believe that is what draws, that is the draw of Christmas. Because it's very easy to inject ourselves into the Christmas story. Because we are just like the men whom God and the women whom God led to see the birth of Christ the Lord. We have common occupations, different personalities, different ways that we express ourselves to God. And they all came. Just like God is calling all of us to come at this time. And to come to the wonder of what it means that Jesus Christ is born. What it means that a Savior has been born into the world. That Jesus Christ is your deliverer. That he's my deliverer. Now, I was thinking about this a week or so ago. And you know one of the great things about babies and Christ being born for babies? You know, we have a new grandchild in our family. And the greatest thing about babies is that they're such good listeners. You know? good listeners, you ever notice you walk by the nursery and you ever see a mother in there with a baby and they're rocking the baby and they're talking. It's a one-way conversation often. And the mother's just talking to each other, oh, I love you so much. I'm praying for you. I so want you, to be this and that. And the baby's just there listening. You're free to say anything to a baby, to express yourself however. And so it is that God chose to enter mankind as a little baby. And people just like me, just like you, were called to come to Jesus. And they're allowed to freely express themselves to Jesus in their own way, their own personalities. And some praised and worshiped, some gave gifts. Some almost sighed in relief. It's been worth it all. Just to be able to be here this moment to see and to understand what this baby needs. Matter of fact, it says Jesus' mother, you know what her reaction was? All these things is she's seeing people come and express themselves to Christ. It says that she collected each moment. Each moment that was different. She stored it in our heart. So what I want us to do, and just very simply here today, I want to take some time and allow you to interject yourself into the story. The story of the birth of the Savior. What would your reaction be if you were there? What would it be if Christ had chosen to be born into our culture today? And we had the blessing of either having angels come to us, or Jesus being parents bringing them to our church and realizing who it is. What would you say? How would you react? And what I want to simply do is I want to give us a chance to do that. To speak to Jesus and speak to the child. And express ourselves to him, as we would want to express him. I'm going to ask you if you would just bow your heads with me for a moment. Just focus. Keep your eyes open and keep closed. I just want you to focus. I want you to imagine with me a stable. It's crudely made. There's a trough there with hay and a blanket. There's Jesus. There's Jesus Christ. And it's just you and Christ. What are you going to say to him? What would you like to say to your Savior? To your God? To your hope, to our salvation? I'm just going to give you a quiet moment to pray right now and speak to the Savior. Picture that in your mind. You have a busy Christmas. There's a lot going on. Have you slowed down enough to talk to your Savior? To worship him. And just take a few moments, and I'm going to lead us in a moment to pray. Thank you that because of my salvation, because of what Christ has done on the cross for me, I'm a child of yours. Father, this moment, this time of year is different in my life than so many in the world. And though I participate in the world's things, Lord, that's not the meaning. And Father, I see you. I see a Savior. I see a beginning. I see a love that could not keep you from, coming to this earth. A love that just compelled you so much to step away from your glories to come for me. in my actions, my attitudes, and my priorities. I want to worship you in all of those things. To be able to say thank you, God. To be able to say I love you. I worship you, Lord. And I pray for each and every one here who knows you as their Lord and Savior. Just continue to ingrain upon our heart the magnitude of what we celebrate. And Father, I pray if there is anyone here today that, you know, we look at it and, you know, it's just kind of glancing off the surface of the story. It doesn't seem to have a depth in our heart. But if there's anyone here who doesn't know you as their Lord and Savior, Father, this would be the day that they'd be able to confess themselves as a sinner. Receive you, Lord, for the payment of their sin. To recognize that God became man to die for us, to make a way for us to be united with our Creator. And I thank you for any of those decisions that are going to be made. And Father, I want to take a moment right now and I want to pray for this church family's outreach. This Monday, as we reach into the community, into many families that you have allowed us to be in contact with. We have a chance to be a cup of cold water given in Jesus' name, but as well we're going to have a chance to plant seeds, to share the true meaning of Christmas. And I thank you, Father, for the part that we've all played in this, and will continue to play. And I pray, Father, that there will be the families that receive these, families that need you as Savior, Father, that will respond to the message, but at the very least even come to the Christmas Eve service to hear the message. I just give that to you. This is a power that only you, Father, can bring because it changes the heart. We can't do that, Lord. Only you can. I pray right now just continue to work in those families so that they will be so ready when they, you know, this time when they hear the truth of what you did for them, for their salvation, Lord, that they would open their hearts to you. I thank you, Father, for the children, for reminding us, Lord, of the Christmas story. Thank you for this church family, for this year you have given us together, through the ups and the downs, through the glories, the trials, Father. I look forward to what you have for us this year to come. And I thank you in my son's name. Stand with me when you get there. We're going to sing all three verses of What Child Is This?